Doctor Who premiered in November of 1963, so 1993 was a landmark year, the franchise's 30th anniversary. And despite the show having been off the air for 4 years, they did celebrate it, with a bizarre charity crossover special between Doctor Who and the British soap opera EastEnders.
Our whole existence is being threatened by a renegade Time Lord known only as the Rani. She hates me. She even hates children.
Hey, do you like that, love?
Clashes.
I tell you, they're going to be the rage in 1994. You've got to get away from here.
Here? Who says? You start shoving me around, you'll know about it.
It's no good. They're in different time zones. To them, we're the strangers.
What are you doing? Leave her alone!
It was weird. But it was more than Virgin did. No, for November of 1993, the Virgin New Adventures ushered in Doctor Who's birthday with one of the most business-as-usual books in its library. Hope you aren't sick of space soldiers yet. This is The Dimension Riders by Daniel Blythe. It's 1993, and the Doctor, Ace, and Bernice Summerfield are visiting the University of Oxford. The Doctor has an old friend there, Professor James Rafferty, but before they can really catch up, the Doctor notices strange fluctuations in time. It's a Thursday, but businesses are closed like it's a Sunday. The headlines on newspapers seem to be changing. There's a time anomaly gradually affecting things. So the Doctor and Ace jump into the TARDIS and try to track it down, leaving Benny behind. Their journey takes them to a dead space station in the 24th century, Station Q4. The occupants of the station are now skeletons, as if they've been dead for years, but other signs indicate that this happened relatively recently. Not long after, a ship called the Icarus arrives. Nice name, guys, that's one step removed from naming your ship the Titanic. This is a rescue ship full of space soldiers, investigating a distress signal coming from the station. Soon after, all hell breaks loose. The space soldiers assume the Doctor and Ace are guilty of whatever happened, but then something made of what appears to be time energy starts wrecking shop. Ace gets grabbed by the soldiers and is taken away on the Icarus, while the Doctor and the Icarus's captain get punted back in time a week, finding themselves on the now very much alive Station Q4. Benny, left behind in modern-day Oxford, hangs out and goes bicycling with one of the students, Tom Chaner. But the longer she stays, the weirder things get. There's a strange, stoic woman in mirror shades who seems to have interest in both Tom and Professor Rafferty. Someone set up an energy trap in Rafferty's office, and clues start to point towards the college's mysterious president. Things are getting complicated, and it only gets worse for Ace when the Icarus is attacked by time soldiers, beings who fire time weapons, which have time effects. Want to incapacitate someone? Hit them with a reverse time wave and revert them into a baby. Want to kill someone? Hit them with some future time and age them to death. It's pretty gruesome, and made even more so when the leader of the time soldiers arrives, a powerful, skeletal creature called the Garvond. A psychic entity that feeds off the time energy created by paradoxes, the Garvond originates from Gallifrey, a creature created from the combined minds imprinted on the Time Lord's supercomputer, the Matrix. No, not that one. The thing is, the Garvond should not exist, as it would require the mind imprint of the Doctor, who insists he erased his imprint from the Matrix ages ago. It's as if someone changed time so that the Doctor never did. Perhaps the same someone who created the alternate timeline we experienced in the last book. Whoever's behind this will have to wait, however. The Garvon's intentions have to be discovered, and his plans have to be stopped. The solution lays in an old Gallifreyan book, though that's going to be quite difficult to obtain with our heroes scattered across space and time. That sounds like a lot of moving parts, and it is, but the plot feels oddly inert for all that's going on. This, I believe, comes down to two things. First is that our three protagonists actually do very little until the end of the book. This is a problem inherited from the classic television show, whose serial format tended to have a set amount of episodes, regardless if the story proposed needed that many half hours of television to tell. This resulted in a lot of old-school Doctor Who stories having the protagonists mess around, make very minimal progress in the plot, and quite commonly having the Doctor and his companions captured and imprisoned for a stint. Of course, this is a book, not a TV show, but if you grew up watching a ton of classic Doctor Who, that Doctor Who television pacing comes second nature to you. There's a lot of the Doctor, Ace, and Benny kind of just fiddling about. And since they're all split up, it's three times the fiddling. There's a scene where the Doctor goes to a space station bar, waxes philosophically with the bartender, but doesn't actually say anything beyond, "Boy, I'm getting old." "Have you ever," the Doctor hesitated, "made a mistake?" he asked. "One you weren't aware of until the consequences became clear?" "You're joking? I've lost count. I get holo cables from my mistakes. I wake up next to them. I wear them. I drink them and throw them up again. Hell, it's not the end of the world." She breathed deeply and gulped another mouthful. "Why, what have you done?" "I'm not sure." "All right." The girl wasn't deterred. "You're having an affair." "No, no." "Well, maybe you should. Maybe that's your problem."
"I doubt it."
"Okay, touchy, aren't we? How old are you?" The Doctor looked past her at the rows and rows of bottles on the chrome shelf.
"I honestly don't recall," he said eventually. "I used to be sure."
"Too old, that's the answer."
Sure, scenes like that can be good for character development and themes and such, if you're committed to using them for that, but this ain't that. This is just the Doctor being woe is me in a bar, not revealing why he's sad to a rando that we've never met before and will never see again. It's a way to pad out page length. And yes, the Doctor, Ace, and Benny all get captured independently and imprisoned at various points in the story, separately from each other, so there's always somebody not actually getting anything done. The other thing that makes the book feel inert is that a lot of the book's big ideas are rehashes of things the Virgin New Adventures have already done. The big villain of the piece, the Garvond, has a similar power set and aesthetic to the Time Worm, and is even defeated in a similar way as the Time Worm initially was in Time Worm Genesis. Both the Time Worm and the Garvond are even ultimate evils predicted by the Matrix on Gallifrey. And as far as these ultimate evils go, Psychic Skeleton Man isn't the most exciting. Though, hold on to that powered by paradoxes thing. There might be something to that. But even more egregious is another round of space soldier drama. We've already seen versions of roughnecks arming up and delivering space violence in Love and War, Deceit, Shadow Mine, and I'd argue Transit. And don't forget this new version of Ace, who is basically Space Marine 24/7. The Virgin New Adventures have been very sci-fi soldier heavy. While the Space Marine thing can trace its origins back to the golden age of science fiction with things like Robert Heinlein's Starship Troopers, it came into its own in a big way with the release of Aliens in 1986, directed by James Cameron. Also, the guy in charge of the Virgin New Adventures worked for the company who published Warhammer 40K. The space soldier thing wasn't new to Doctor Who at this time either. Earthshock was a pretty well-known example. Of course, just because a trope is popular and played out doesn't mean it's bad, but the space soldiers in the Dimension Riders are the least interesting space soldiers yet. They don't have a gimmick, they don't have exceptionally cool tech, and worst of all, they have no personality, both as a unit and as individual soldiers. They have names and they have guns and that's it. They're just a series of warm bodies for the bad guys to run through without much hassle. They might as well have sent the Star Wars Stormtroopers. And yet we spend a lot of time with them, running through corridors and getting killed by Time Soldiers. Ace, being a space soldier herself, doesn't bother comparing herself to these guys. She's just the one space soldier with a sense of style and plot armor. All of this bookended with what are becoming the biggest tropes of the Virgin New Adventures. The book opens with the TARDIS having an upset stomach and being temperamental, and the book ends with Benny and Ace reflecting on how they're not sure if they can trust the Doctor anymore. You know, the same opening and ending as the last book. So, a bunch of old tropes and characters that struggle to move the plot forward. It should be no surprise that The Dimension Riders is one of the most unremarkable books in the entire series. It feels very paint by numbers. But, That's not to say that it has nothing under the hood. I think there's one interesting, worthwhile idea here, and that comes in the Benny third of the book with the mysteries of Oxford. But before we get into that, just who wrote this one, anyway? Daniel Blythe was born in 1969 in Maidstone, England, and has been watching Doctor Who since the age of 5. The earliest event I remember is John Pertwee regenerating into Tom Baker. Since then, I've caught up with various older stories on video, as well as numerous magazines. There was a time when I considered abandoning the program. Paradise Towers was just too silly for words. Thankfully, things got better, and I think the show was getting back on track when it disappeared. After graduating from Maidstone Grammar School, he went on to get a degree in modern language from St. John's College, which is part of the University of Oxford, so hey, write what you know, I guess. He began getting short stories and poetry published in small publications starting around 1991, including some Doctor Who fan fiction in the fanzine Scarrow. I always start with ideas, which I jot down in a notebook for inspiration. From there on, my writing is pretty fluid and flexible, although I always write directly onto the keyboard, because I like the immediacy of it. When I revise my manuscript, I often read something which I think is crap, while at the time I thought it was good. I always try and get rid of any floweriness in my writing. Kill your babies! In 1992, Blythe pitched the Dimension Riders to Virgin and was quickly picked up, though we'd have to rework it almost immediately after the shakeups of introducing Bernice Summerfield and later the recharacterization of Ace. I'm under the impression that the Oxford third of the book was added to accommodate Benny, whom Blythe liked, but he struggled with New Ace. The New Ace isn't likable as a person. She's not very sympathetic and is no longer a reference point for the reader. And of course, there was the whole thing about being part of a multi-book story arc, the alternate history cycle. And Blythe got into contact with Jim Mortimer, who was writing the book before his, and Kate Orman, who was writing the book after. I can't imagine the alternate history cycle affecting the story too much, though. There's a prologue and an epilogue featuring an unnamed party who's been manipulating the timeline, and mention of the Doctor's imprint not getting erased from the Matrix, but you could easily have had the Garvon show up without that detail. Besides, the book was already invested in a lot of time-manipulating shenanigans. What's one more manipulation to the pile? Time is the underlying concept of Doctor Who, and I'm fascinated by the concept of the vortex and what's lurking within it, neither in one time zone or another. The way I brought the Garvond, the main villain of the Dimension Riders, into being hints back to a couple of things touched upon in Time's Crucible and Remembrance of the Daleks. Blythe's writing style, at least at this point in his career, which is actually pretty storied, but that's for another video, is pretty precise and almost clinical. As Blythe said earlier, the first thing to get cut was anything that seemed too flowery. So, the writing's actually very, very dry. At 3:23 p.m. on November 18th, 1993, a Thursday, a black Porsche, like a wedge cut from the night, sidled in to park outside the Randolph Hotel in Oxford. The girl who checked in was tall and attractive, with short black hair and mirrored sunglasses. She carried a briefcase at her side, as dark and glossy as the car she drove. The receptionist didn't report the arrival. Had the day been the following Sunday, she would have recognized, with a jolt, the face that was all over the newspapers and TV as the wanted assassin of the Home Office Minister. But as the murder had yet to take place, she did not bat an eyelid. Honestly, I'm surprised Blythe let in that, like a wedge cut from the night bit. This scene, of course, relates to the modern-day Oxford plotline, which is a later addition to the story with the introduction of Bernice Summerfield, and b, where all the good stuff is. I've been pretty negative in this video thus far, but the Dimension Riders isn't a complete wash, and that's thanks to the Oxford third of the story. For one, it's just a nice visual and tonal contrast to the bang-bang soldier action in the other two-thirds of the book. Not to mention that Bernice Summerfield is now the fun character. The Seventh Doctor is a dour, brooding manipulator, and Ace is a violent, angsty warrior. Benny's over here flirting with students and making jokes and sneaking about the college halls in search for clues. But what really makes the Oxford stuff work for me is the President, the book's secondary villain.
We eventually learn that the president is a renegade Time Lord who is using his TARDIS and a sexy woman robot assassin to kill people and create paradoxes for the Garbon to feed off of. The robot assassin can change their appearance and likes wearing giant mirror shades, so it's kind of like a gender-flipped T-1000 from Terminator 2, another James Cameron film. Funny, that. And while we're pointing out parallels, some of the more hardcore Doctor Who fans just recognized another. A Time Lord posing as a staff member of a prestigious English university, running around the campus on bicycles with some of the students, a mysterious book that's the key to the imprisonment of an ultimate evil? There sure is a lot of Shada in the Dimension Riders. For the uninitiated, Shada was a partially filmed but never completed Doctor Who serial that was intended to air for the show's 17th season in 1979, starring the Fourth Doctor and the Second Romana, and written by script editor Douglas Adams. Yes, that Douglas Adams. This story, about attempts to break into a Time Lord prison, was shelved due to rampant inflation and union strikes, and as such gained a treasured reputation among Doctor Who fans as a lost story, and lost in a much more interesting way than the BBC just erased the tapes to make room. With Douglas Adams becoming a very famous novelist not long after the serial's production, there was a lot of what could have been speculation. Some of the elements in Shada would be adopted into Douglas Adams' book Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency, namely the character of the time-traveling Cambridge professor. Just have to flip the switch from Time Lord to not a Time Lord for trademark reasons. In 1992, the world finally got to see Shada. Sort of. BBC Video took what existing footage had been shot, and for what was missing, intercut new linking narration bits with Tom Baker.
Krog? Shada!
The untransmitted story.
Why wasn't it transmitted?
Of course we didn't finish it. Starring Dennis Carey and Christopher Neame, written by Douglas Adams. I thought it was a very good script. And it was an invisible spaceship. Douglas said anyone can design a visible spaceship, but to design an invisible spaceship, that needs imagination. I think he said that, or did he say... I think he said genius, yes. He said genius. Poor old Douglas. I wonder what became of him.
It would be the first of many, many times that people tried to get a definitive version of Shada off the ground, including a 2003 Big Finish audio adaptation where the role of the Doctor was recast with Paul McGann's Eighth Doctor, an unofficial version in 2011 from Doctor Who's most butthurt fan, Ian Levine, that used animation and voice actors to recreate the missing footage, a 2012 novelization done by Gareth Roberts, a 2012 audiobook of the novelization with original cast members Lala Ward and John Leeson, and in 2017, an official home video release with new animation for the missing scenes. And I seriously doubt that'll be the final version. Where's my Shada VR simulation, you cowards? Now, I'm not saying that the Dimension Riders is a straight-up rip-off of Shada. There are more ways it's different than it's similar. I just wouldn't be surprised if this mythical, lost Doctor Who story was a point of inspiration. If you're a Doctor Who fan in 1992, you've probably caught wind of this Shada VHS tape. And if you suddenly have to add a whole new third of your book because the Virgin New Adventures is introducing a new companion, why not seek ideas from Shada? That brings up an interesting ethical question, utilizing ideas from incomplete works. Not copying wholesale, which I must stress, the Dimension Riders does not copy the plot wholesale, but seeing a good idea in a work that was never properly published and going, hey, that's a good idea, shame for it to go to waste, I should use it, is probably okay? And just between you and me, I think Shada is kind of pants and was Douglas Adams' worst Doctor Who script, so I'm all for stripping it for parts and trying to make a good story out of it. And this was a tangent anyway. I wanted to tell you why I really like the President character. So, the President. He's a renegade Time Lord, meaning he's run away from Gallifrey, broken away from Time Lord society, and is just doing his own thing. You know, like the Rani, or the Master, or the Doctor. And that's what's so fun about him. He's a second-generation renegade Time Lord, a renegade after being a renegade stopped being novel or really all that interesting. It was the third renegade who intrigued him, a Prydonian who called himself the Doctor. He too had stolen a TARDIS, but according to the files, that had been a minor offense in comparison to his interference on numerous planets. Twice, the Doctor had been put on trial for his actions, and both times had actually come out of it quite well. There seemed to be a subtext contained in the report, a kind of grudging acceptance of the Doctor's existence, and, indeed, of the occasional necessity of his intervention. The President, known on Gallifrey as Epsilon Delta, had been a bottom-rung Time Lord on Gallifrey, an entry-level lackey who felt his talents, education, and hard work was being unappreciated, and was going to waste. And while he was slaving away in the labs, doing a good job without as much as an Employee of the Month plaque to show for it, over there was the Doctor, some idiot who nearly flunked out of the academy, who stole a TARDIS and ran off to play cricket in the 1920s or start a war with the Daleks and just started creating messes everywhere he ended up. And what did the Time Lords do about this bumbling fool? They put him on trial multiple times and he got off with the equivalent of a slap on the wrist. Oh, and also, they made him President! The Doctor was the President of Gallifrey for a time, and he's not even smart, right? Epsilon Delta has worked hard his whole life, and what does he have to show for it? This briefcase and this haircut!
I'm sorry, isn't that—
Yeah, that's me, all right. And the guy standing next to me is President Gerald Ford. And this is when I was on tour with the Smashing Pumpkins. Oh, and here's a picture of me in outer space.
You. When in outer space? You.
Sure. You've never been? Would you like to see my Grammy Award?
No!
Epsilon Delta is the Frank Grimes of Gallifrey. And much like Frank Grimes, he's snapped. He's so pissed off at what he perceives as this freeloader coasting through life that he's mockingly imitating him. Epsilon Delta steals a TARDIS, takes the name the President, you know, like the Doctor who is the President. He builds a robot companion who's an awesome sexy assassin, almost a parody of Ace, and he starts slamming head first into the space-time continuum. And his equivalent to Frank Grimes grabbing the electric cables is the President working with the Garvond, a paradox-consuming super beast. And much like Frank Grimes, let's just say it doesn't turn out great for the President. Previous examples of renegade Time Lords have been shown to be the Doctor's equals, talented, intelligent, individualistic Gallifreyans with strong goals and methods. The President is not that. He's a loser who's trying to do what the winners do without really understanding what that entails, both pathetic and dangerous at the same time. It's a very different and very fun take on the renegade Time Lord concept that it makes up for a lot of the dullness of the other two-thirds of the book. And at the end of the day, that's what I ask for in a Doctor Who story. Show me something I haven't seen before. You've been given a franchise that, by design, can go anywhere and do anything. The Doctor can fight mad scientists in Atlantis one day and face off against space Margaret Thatcher's candy henchmen the next. To be given the opportunity to write for this beloved science fiction franchise and devolve into well-worn tropes and unmemorable villains should be a crime. It makes you crave something as silly as Paradise Towers or an EastEnders crossover. The Dimension Riders is a book so by the numbers in so many places that it can slot in easily at any point in the series, even in the middle of a complex story arc about alternate timelines. So I hold on to the President, this disgruntled white-collar Time Lord who snapped and is going around in Dr. Cosplay, creating paradoxes. I hold on to him like a life preserver in a storm of mediocrity. Would I recommend the Dimension Riders? It's mostly inoffensive, but I would suggest skimming to the Benny parts of the book. That's where the good stuff is. Next time. What's this? A girl writing a Doctor Who book? Those 1993 SJWs have gone mad! Man, I can't believe it's taken me this long to talk about Kate Orman.